We gaan Europa in, op zoek naar visionairs. Dit is het verhaal van de dag, maar welk verhaal is dat precies als het om Europa gaat? Want nu begint de geschiedenis ook vorm aan te nemen in Europa. Dit is the time, maar welke kant gaat het dan precies op? En zijn er mensen die ons een richting kunnen wijzen? Laten we met z'n allen die kant op gaan. In dat kader presenteer ik u Ulrike Gero. Zij is initiatiefneemster en directeur van European Democracy Lab in Berlijn. Zij is ook een ondersteuner van het initiatief Europe, a new version is available. En eigenlijk is haar grote droom, zou je kunnen zeggen, een Europese republiek. Ver voorbij het klassieke ideaal van de soevereiniteit. Ze schreef er ook een manifest over samen met Robert Menasse. En zij is een onvermoeibaar strijdster voor het Europese ideaal. Een echte Europese denktanker. Dat doet ze al 20 jaar. Nu is halteplaats Felix Meritus. Dames en heren, een warm welkom voor Ulrike Gero.
Work yet? Yet it should come. Okay, so it's a real pleasure to be here, not only because you have the sun and the sun wasn't shining in Berlin, so it's nice to spend an afternoon in Amsterdam. And yes, I'm very happy that I have been invited to give you an idea about how I could see a European utopia. And I'm just coming down from the third floor where there was a super play on Europe and how Europe developed and how there's a big need for common places, common space, public citizens, the commons, a different Europe and all of this. And I hope that I can deliver a story which basically fits to the play that we need a new democracy and we need to think, to rethink profoundly Europe. So, crisis, yeah, I picked this up from an artist in Moscow Biennale last week. So we cry for the crisis, it's really sad. So what we are experiencing is perhaps this. We are living in an hallucination, because perhaps the nation state is an hallucination. I mean, you don't know what you make out of this, it's from the same artist, but keep that, that's the theme of the presentation. Now, if we are talking utopia, we need some sentences that allow us to be utopian, which is Albert Einstein is a comfortable sentence for this. Only a really good idea is one which seems completely illusionary in the beginning. So I'm going to present you now an idea which seems completely illusionary in the beginning, and the question is whether you go with me some paths on this way. I'm also German, so you know, in critical times with critical theory, it's good to read Theodor Adorno again, and the sentence from Theodor Adorno is, because what is can change, that what is not everything. That's also utopian. We are going to build a different thing than that what we have, which is the European Republic is under construction, and that is my suggestion for the topic of today. Why? Because if you say republic, you say res publica, you say common, and what you give to people is ownership. The republic is uniting citizens and not integrating states. The discussion we have today is about integration of nation states. It's not about uniting citizens. The republic is about uniting citizens, and it's basically that everybody finds its place in the republic, and I'm very happy to present that postcard here because you are Dutch, most of you, I guess, and you know where this barcode comes from. It's from Rem Koolhaas. It's what Rem Koolhaas designed for the Euronotes, and it only came second in the competition for the Euronotes, and that's why we have these bridges. The Germans were too conservative, and so they wanted the bridges and not this sort of smart barcode by then in 2002. So now I steal the barcode, which is public in the internet, and I build around the barcode of Rem Koolhaas, the European Republic, because this has not the same emotional tag. The thing is that United States of Europe is yesterday because the flag is basically appalling, pulls people away, the flag has been burned at ECB demonstrations, wherever, but it didn't, or my suggestion is, it doesn't function like an emotional carrier like European Republic because it is about integration of states. So I had the enormous chance in 95 to work for Jacques Delors, which was the very big president of the European Commission between 85 and 95. And Jacques Delors once said, you cannot fall in love with a single market. Europe needs a soul. Respublica is citizens, is the common good. Perhaps we can find in, perhaps we can fall in love with a republic, but not with a single market. What we did, basically, if you go since the Treaty of Maastricht, which is a Dutch town, right? 92, I remember quite well. I took my first job by then. It's we disentangled state and market. And for everybody who's sort of smart in political economy knows that what we did in the Maastricht Treaty could not work, will not work, and will never work. Because we left fiscal and social policy at the nation state level. We put economy and monetary integration on the European level, and it just cannot function. We knew it by then, because I by then was in an office and we were writing that sort of core Europe paper, and we were arguing we need a fiscal union, we need a taxation union, we still need this, we didn't do it for 20 years, so the system is broken, and we knew from the very beginning that the system is broken. This cover, what you see, is the new cover book of Jürgen Habermas, The Lure of Technocracy. What we are ending in the European system is technocracy. This is just a very quick chart to tell you that most people are not happy with the way European democracy functions. And by the way, need to be very quick because I was told I have 40 minutes. Actually, I only have 30, so you need to speed up with me. I'm sorry. That's again to say that what you see in you know the green things are people who like actually the project of United States of Europe. You see that it's roughly only a third of people who in the big member states, which are France, UK, and Germany, sorry that I don't have Dutch data here, but it's basically only a third of people left who like the idea of United States of Europe. And then we can really question ourselves whether we need a utopia, because if only have a third of people who love the idea, perhaps we should find a different idea. So what don't we like about the European democracy? And essentially what we don't like is we don't have a parliament, a European parliament, that has the right of initiative. We have a commission which has the right of initiative, but which is no government. And then we have a council which is permanently deadlocking interests of the citizens in the European Council, and we see this all over the place. And it cannot work. What is also the problem in the European system is that we have governance, which is basically everybody has a sort of participatory right, but nobody is never responsible for what comes out of European decisions. So governance is basically ownership for everybody, but responsibility for none. And perhaps we should make a European government, and then you have a clear responsibility setting. What you also do have, we have close to no opposition in the European Parliament, and we have no reversibility of policy. That is what the Greek experienced many times. You can always vote, but you have no choice. That is what Colin Crouch calls post-democracy. You can always vote, but you have no choice. Post-democracy, that's the system we are in. Thomas Piketty, who I guess you all know, the capital in the 21st century, therefore gave an interview to Spiegel, which is a German weekly, and he said, we have created a monster. I tried to find this monster to just mirror ourselves in the world we are living in, and then I tried to pick up different quotes on monsters, and I found an interesting one from Gramsci. When the old world dies and the new one isn't born, we live in the times of the monsters. So my argument is that's pretty much the situation Europe is in. We cannot reform. We are basically alternativlos, like we say in German. We are turning in circles. We don't get our utopia right. So we are living in the times of the monsters, and everybody's experiencing that these times are no good. So then you go back to say, okay, what did the founding fathers want from Europe? I mean, I went back and I found this very nice quote from Jean Monnet. The so-called national interests are only the interests of national political and economic elites in whose balances sheet citizens' interests are only written off. You find this applicable to current times? I mean, I do. The next quote I found was from Walter Hallstein, first German commissioner of the European Commission. The ultimate goal of European integration is therefore to overcome the nation state. I can read it again. The ultimate goal of European integration is therefore to overcome the nation state. I wouldn't see so many politicians in Germany, probably not in the Netherlands too, who would say these sentences in such a clear way. So I felt like, let's pick these sentences up. Yeah. And then we saw, you saw, we saw, but I'm German, so I was really appalled by the discussion we had in the past five crisis years where we hardworking Germans paid for the Greek, but the Dutch were sort of hiding behind us, I must say. Anyway, now that we have a little bit more analysis of what really was happening through the crisis years, it's basically that Germany, through all these euro crisis things, earned 100 million euros through negative interest rates over the period of 2010 to 2014. The overall Greek debt to Germany is 90 billion. If you do the addition or the subtraction, you get a 10 million plus surplus for Germany. We didn't pay a cent so far. And the moment that you contrast that figures with what the Foucaultian knowledge order in German press wanted to tell you about these victims of Germans who need to carry the whole burden of the euro crisis, you can find a little disruption between the reality and between what we have been reading 5 years. So what does it bring me to? The problem of the Greek crisis, the Grexit, the so-called Grexit, is not a nation-to-nation sort of hard-working German to poor Greeks or whatever thing. I pulled a chart from the German Employers Association, and this chart tells you one thing. The bubbles, the violet bubbles, are good, and when you're not in a violet bubble, it's bad. What I mean is these are the clusters of European industries, and the clusters of European industries have close to nothing to do with national borders. What they do have to do with is basically center, periphery, and rural, urban. You are in a rural area, you are poor, you are urban, you are better, you are in the center, you are best, you are periphery, you are bad. It's not so much about Greece and Germany. If I took then these figures basically for France to make this illustration even more clear, on the red side, what you see is unemployment in France, mostly rural areas, if you know France. On the black is Front National. So rural means unemployed, means Front National. Means what? The framing, the national framing of politics does not make sense because aggregated data give you no reality for France today. If France have an unemployment of 17%, it doesn't explain the vote of Marine Le Pen, it doesn't explain the rural-urban divide, it doesn't explain the policy choices we need to do. And the policy choices we have to do is that regions are much more important. We need to care for regions, and nation state is not the story we are in, but we are contouring the policies we have in Brussels still after national borders. To give you a little idea how sort of futile national borders are, I have a little clip, and I hope now that this clip will work. So we learned one thing, that national borders are really static, right? I mean, they never change. This is why, you know, we cannot even change them in the way we think, because the national border is a national border is a national border. So I thought, that where does this come from, this talk about national borders? And it basically comes from Thomas Hobbes. And it's always painted like this, the Leviathan. You know this Leviathan, if you look and you Google it, you get this. Basically, what you see is a man with power and, you know, masculine power, and this is a Leviathan nation state. Okay. I see some relation, yeah, between sort of Leviathan nation state sort of pictures, male dominance, and so. And then I felt like, do we like this? Not really. And then I thought, Europe? Huh? Can we just, you know, she is Europe? She? Okay, the moment we have understood that Europe is a she, it's interesting to see that freedom is also a she. Yeah? Freedom is Böcklin, painted in 1871, and she's beautiful, right? indifference to Jesus at the cross, she stands basically really floating. Yeah? She governs on the sky. She governs the earth, the globe, because the picture is round. She has all insignias of earthen power, which is the eagle. She has the insignias of Res Publica Christiana, which is the palm thing. And she stands on the rock, and she governs what? Without borders. She governs borderlessness. The most important thing, look at this, is this bonnet rouge, which is the bonnet révolutionnaire. It's interesting that the freedom that she wears, le bonnet. Who wears it? Marianne wears it. Delacroix, you know this picture, is Marianne, French Revolution, has the bonnet. You know where the bonnet comes from? The bonnet is bull testicles that the Amazons cut to put them on their head to win the army of the Traca 2,000 years ago. They wanted the male testosterone energy on their head to win over the Thracian army, and they did. So now we go back. Because if it's bull testicles, you see the relation that perhaps we need to castrate the Toro who basically hijacked the Europe to make Europe free. Wouldn't this perhaps be the solution? What the three pictures are telling us, Europe is a she. She has been hijacked by a bull. The she is a freedom. The République is a she. So the three things. Europe is a she, freedom is a she, and La République is a she, which makes, you have the postcards, Europe is free only as republic. This is what history of the arts is telling us, and I found this pretty exciting. Then, I felt like, you know, a contrast to this Brussels picture, you know, who won that song contest, Conchita Wurst, yeah? We don't know really if she is she or, you know, but she was representing Europe in a way that probably Donald Tusk cannot represent Europe. Yeah? He or she had so many million. So where does it come from? If you read the brilliant essay of Sigmund Freud about Leonardo da Vinci, arguing that Leonardo da Vinci, what we don't know, but we assume that he was gay, then Freud argues that he painted Mona Lisa in a way that if you look carefully, you cannot distinguish whether Mona Lisa is a man or a woman. And that makes her so beautiful. So if this is what history is telling us, yeah, then this is the modern Mona Lisa, which is basically that we need to integrate the female side into the male European side to make Europe fertile. I repeat, she is Europe, she is freedom, and she, La République, is also a woman. So now, the first picture of Europe is this, 1588, that was the first map, again it's a she. What we learn of this map is that whereas today we always have these sort of silly discussions about I need to leave the European Union, Brexit, Grexit, whatever, and we always discuss this vertical, more Europe, more nation state, we learn in 1588, Europe is a woman, we know this now, but also that it has a corporal language. Europe is a body. And if you are a body, then the message is that each and everybody has its organic space and place. So I gave this card to a couple of British deputies who are now completely in concern about this Brexit discussion, said, look, if you cut that left arm that you share with the Danes, yeah, you will be dead anyway because an arm doesn't live alone. And Europe would be amputated. So it's not really good. Perhaps you could think a little bit more organically that everybody has to contribute something to Europe, and that is the corporal language of that body, which again is a woman. So now we go. If we take this, if you see this map, you see also who is in and who is not in Europe. Well, for instance, the Ukrainians, by then Galician, are obviously in. The people of Europe are all in. They all have a space in the dress of Europe. But she has no nation states in her. Yeah? What she has is regions. And this is interesting. I picked this card again. I'm very happy to be in the Netherlands for the first time because this is the card that Heineken, it's your beer, right? Heineken beer. Heineken, in the producer, in 92 drafted that map of Europe of the regions and said, look, can we go back to the regions, which is Savoyen, Alemannien, Tirol, Scotland, Catalonia, all these regions we know, because obviously there are borders, there are language borders, there are religious borders, there are a lot of cultural little borders, but no nation state borders, and that's the important thing. So if we were to do this, what could we come up with? And that is the essential sort of policy message which I would like you to get or understand, which is if we still have the project to build a political entity on this continent, and this is still the project. In Germany, it's still the constitutional, you know, in the constitutional treaty, it's still Lissabon, Maastricht. We have said this. We want ever closer union, and we want a political union. Then a political union is constituted on what? Political equality of all citizens. And we don't have political equality of all citizens, because the French Revolution brought what? Political equality beyond classes. 1789 was the momentum where we were basically acknowledging that all people are equal beyond classes. Today, what I suggest is that the peaceful revolution of Europe today is that we are all equal beyond nation states. And we are not. Because what do I mean? We don't have voting equality. My sons happen to live in Paris. They vote the European Parliament under different conditions than I. I vote our Parliament under different conditions than you. We don't have tax equality. We don't pay the same income taxes. We don't have same access to social rights. So we should have these fundamental three principles as citizens of the European Res Publica, of the European Republic, because without political equality, we don't construct a political entity. What we do have today is we have equality for market actors, and market actors like companies can shop around for wages and for taxes, and they can use the system and, by the way, milk the system, but we cannot shop around. We do not have equality for citizens, so I think it should be inverse. We should create a European Republic which is in protection of the European citizens and not allow competition among citizens, but put competition again back to the markets, because competition is for markets, but equality is for people. If we were to do this, we could take the, if you count something like 50 regions we have, the authentic identitarian regions in Europe, like Bavaria, Catalonia, Tyrol, and so on and so forth, and we make a system which I modeled here like an American system. We have a directly elected president for the European Republic. We do have transnational lists, which is not so much utopian. It's in nearly every party program of the European parties today that we want to have transnational lists. We do a one-man, one-vote system, like, you know, political equality, and then each and every region could have a governor. We could bring back much of regulation and democracy to the regions where people want to have their government, their self-control, and so about how they make a marmalade and how, you know, these little things that we always are cheating around. And then you could send two senators to a Congress or a Senate in Brussels, and we would have a European Congress, which an arbitrage system with a directly elected president, which would give us obviously also an identity tool. So now I picked up this picture because I feel like obviously it's the discussion of today, the refugees. I feel like the refugee question is the avant-garde question for Europe, because what is avant-garde in the sense of art? Avant-garde is always the thing you need to be measured against. So we will be measured against the refugees. And why I'm saying this? Because our task is overcoming nation states. That is the whole topic of this little presentation that I gave. If we are overcoming nation states, we can be avant-garde for the world, because in the next sort of 2,000 years, I think we will need to overcome nation states on the global level, which is basically what Immanuel Kant already wrote in The Eternal Peace, because the dignity of man is indivisible. And if we could start in Europe to overcome divisions among nation states, we could be a global avant-garde for what Kant already called in 1792 eine globale Weltgesellschaft. So the translation must be something like a global republican entity. So I think we could live a little bit in that avant-garde utopia to comply with it. I give you and I invite you perhaps, because I need to be so quick, to come up after this event on the third floor. There will be a discussion and we can detail this. But what are the three best or big important differences between a state, United States of Europe, and republic. The first is that the state is about right of no interference. I am my state, my Leviathan, and here I stand and nobody tells me what I have to do. This is Viktor Orbán today and we don't like it, right? Because if you say this as a private person, for instance, somebody's dying next to you and you don't help him, this is a legal crime in most of European legislations. It's fahrlässige unterlassene Hilfeleistung, you know, you understand me. And if you apply this to states, then it's pretty much the same, yeah? So what is that right of interference? Up in the play, there was a super person always interviewed who then said in these quotes, we need to think about morality. And this is what republic offers, because what is the interesting distinction between republic and state or public or republic and democracy is that at the end of the day, the democracy of Athens was a formal majority voting thing. But you can get a majority voting an immoral thing. The majority of the street is no democracy if it has no normal binding. And this is what we need to understand, that instead of offering formal participation and formal majority, which can really turn sour when the formal majority will vote for the first FPÖ mayor in Vienna in sort of 2 or 3 weeks to come, I think we need to reflect that we thought democracy is about participation, but actually it's about social bodies embedded in a moral scheme. And this is precisely what, since Platon on this continent, we frame with the word republic. Republic was Platon, republic was Cicero, Aristoteles goes to Kant, goes to Rousseau. What we do since 2,000 years on this continent when we create a political entity is a republic. So I think we should just take care of this sort of cultural heritage to build a European republic which is under construction. So some of you got already this postcard. I had some. If you turn the postcards around, there's a barcode. If you scan this barcode into your iPhone, you get an appeal. If you read the appeal, you can sign it. If you were to sign it, you would help me and us with the European Democracy Lab, because I want many, many, many signatures for this new Europe. I already have very prominent signatures. Thomas Piketty kindly signed, Sigismund Baumann signed, Gesine Schwan, a couple of people. I'm chasing Rem Koolhaas to sign, so perhaps you know him, you can tell him. And because I'm in Amsterdam, I have another wish or idea, because in summary of what I want is, I talked a lot about this female side, which we need to integrate into the male Leviathan Europe and so on and so forth. And you saw the barcode of Rem Koolhaas, which are all these, you know, colors, barcode running into each other. So with a German concept artist, Valeska Peschke, she designed that hat. We talked a lot about revolutionary caps and hats. And my idea is that Rem Koolhaas could meet Christo, who were packing the Reichstag and the whole thing. And then we would start knitting, we would spread needles across Europe, and we would start knitting that cap out of wool, right? And everybody, each village, you know, from Ukraine down to Portugal, we would be knitting a huge, huge female warm revolutionary cap. And where would we put it? We put it over the phallic building of the European Parliament in Brussels, and we make a happening of a European revolution. Thank you very much.